That's me, right? Good morning. So wonderful to see you all. I bid you all welcome. I'm the Reverend Charlotte Bell and a member of this church, and I'm pleased to share worship with you today while Pastor Maureen is on rest and renewal, and you will come back bright-eyed and perky next week. For no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, or where you were worshiping from, you are welcome here. We welcome everyone here. We welcome you who are worshiping from home or on your vacation spot. We are glad you're here partaking in our service. Today is the 10th Sunday of Pentecost, and we'll continue this summer's preaching series on the alternative semi-continuous Old Testament reading from Genesis this morning, 32 verses 22-32, where Jacob wrestles with the angel and God renames him Israel. Struggles are an occurrence of life, but when you're matched face to face with an angel and God, oh man, yikes. We'll hear more about that face to face encounter in a little bit. I have two announcements to share with you. One, the end of summer party will be held Sunday, August 13th at the Dart family's lake house on Babuzik Lake here in Amherst. So, and if you're wanting to come, please RSVP to the Meredith Dart and then refer to your bulletin for her contact or the church's website on the events section for more information. Vacation Bible School also starts on Monday, August 14th. It's never too late to inquire about registration or volunteering or even donating may be easy by accessing the Amazon wish list, also on the church's website under Church School. So I now invite the ushers to please come forward, unless anybody has an announcement. No, they're coming forward to pass the friendship registers. Why don't we sit back, listen to this morning's prelude, take a cleansing breath or two, and enjoy being here in God's house.
Thank you. Please rise as you are able, in body or spirit. Beloved disciples, welcome. Some of us come weary and hungry, while others come rested and content. Still others come ready to wrestle with the questions that keep us up at night. No matter how you enter this space, we say, come, let us worship God together. Together, we notice the fatigue we carry, the exhaustion that comes from our hunger for care and connection with one another and with God. Yet, when God says to feed one another, we answer, we have nothing but together. Then, let us wrestle with our hungers that we may be transformed into people who seek and find God all around us. So that when God calls us to feed the hungry and struggle for those in need of help, we answer, In you we have everything. Use us as you will. Amen. Now, would you please join me in unison with the reading of the prayer of invocation and the Lord's Prayer. Loving God, you have called us into a wholehearted relationship with you. You have asked us to leave behind all we possess and live out our faith with passion and integrity. We thank you for the deep love you have shown toward us. Forgive us when we take our relationship with you for granted, when we let the fire of our early commitment cool and allow other things to take priority in our lives. Give us strength to hold on to you no matter what comes our way. Give us courage to wrestle honestly with the things we do not understand, to continually work out our salvation with fear and trembling, to grapple daily with what it means to faithfully follow you. We are your people, chosen and named by you. Grant us your continued blessing and mark us with your love as we seek to live as your disciples in the world. We pray all of this in the name of the one who came to reconcile the world to you, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now is a time in our service when we reach out to greet and acknowledge one another, however it is most comfortable to you, whether it is by bowing or holding your hands to your heart and receiving it back, giving it back to the person that you're intending it for, or whether you want to shake your hand or give a hug and a smile. The peace of God be with you. Let the congregation say amen.
Amen.
This morning's scripture is from Genesis chapter 32. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the thigh muscle that is on the hip socket, because he struck Jacob on the hip socket at the thigh muscle. Here ends our scripture reading. May God bless it to our understanding.
I ask if you will pray with me. O Lord, bless old words and new messages, old messages and new words. Be with us in the offering and the listening to your holy words, and in this time as a gift of preparation, hopefulness, and love. Amen. So many years ago, there was a television commercial promoting a new toy for all kids age 6 and over, Rock'em Sock'em Robots. And it began with two kids on a front step facing one another, and the exchange went like this: "I can beat any kid on the block." "Oh yeah," the other child said. "Yeah." And the challenge begins. The two kids that are opposite at this game, holding on to the controls with their thumbs — they're not cell phones back in those days, but with their thumbs. That's been early cell phones starting. They're throwing punches of the two robots, one red and the other blue. Pow, bam. And the bright, all standing on this bright yellow boxing ring. Well, the robots are slugging it out, left to the jaw, and pow. One child proclaims, "Oh, my block is knocked off." Rock'em Sock'em Robots, throw a left, throw a right, knock his block off, and you're a winner. Sounds like such fun, and I don't know if you or your children or a neighbor or your cousins had one. Well, as a teen, I especially enjoyed watching Muhammad Ali. All his televised events on boxing events, the moving about, the throws, the punches — it made Rock'em Sock'em Robots seem like a lot of fun. Well, I never received the toy Rock'em Sock'em Robots, and nor do I need one at this point in my life. But I did have the opportunity not too long ago to play the game. I was pretty disappointed. The whole game just seemed a lot smaller than it was. I thought it was gonna be like this. It was this tiny little thing. And the idea of being able to box the way of, and doing toy wrestling without causing any physical injury to another person, it sounds like a fun exercise in sportsmanship and safe competition. Well, participating in a game or a sport such as boxing, or perhaps trying your hand at the latest rage of pickleball, is about having fun. But it's also about demonstrating resilience and overcoming the odds. After all, don't all of us want to demonstrate the intelligence and a sense of quick perception and dexterity and power and independence? I've described some of the physical struggles that can be encountered participating in sports. And likewise, they can be compared to one's work and one's everyday life. You don't succumb in these tough times, but you may step back and think, and you ponder and pray and reevaluate what you are doing or not doing to attain the outcome you're hoping for when you're having a difficult time. I know that I have struggled at times with the darker side of life. God and I have often kept company during the nights and the early mornings, watching the sunrise. And perhaps you too have shared these quiet times with God, where the unknown and the thoughts of one brain just don't shut down. And the elusive sleep that you're hoping for just does not come, despite the warm milk, the chamomile tea, or the feeble attempt of reading and beckoning sleep to come while you're reading, and it just doesn't come. It's in these dark nights that we are challenged, but they also can be a time of healing. In his book, Dark Nights of the Soul, former monk and psychologist Thomas More states, "Everyone can use life's darkest moments to deepen and restore wholeness to their souls. It is often the case that we grow more during our struggles than at any other time. And there is some wisdom to be found in the darkness. A dark night is not a puzzle. It's not a puzzle to be solved or figured out, or a crisis to be fixed. It is a period of enrichment and of soul growth. Those dark nights, we may feel alone, and it may be in the loneliness that we often are confronted face to face in a wrestling match with God. We're not powing God, and God's not powing us back. But yet, in Isaiah, we hear God saying to Abraham and his descendants, 'Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid. I am your God, and I will strengthen you. And I will help you, and I will uphold you with my victorious hand.'" Well, in this week's text, we hear of Jacob and his ongoing struggle in our Genesis passage that Paul read from today. Jacob and his family have finally left the homestead of his father-in-law in Laban, only to encounter his long-lost and embittered brother Esau. Jacob sends Esau a gift, along with his women and his children, across the riverbank. He spends the night extremely worried and anxious about what might transpire with Esau. He is experiencing his own dark night. He's alone in the desert wilderness, and he's feeling as if he is losing control of his life. And his struggle is real, as he begins wrestling with God and himself. That long, lonesome night, an angelic stranger visited Jacob. The passage says that a man wrestled with him all night long. Some say it was an angel, and others say it was God. And together they struggled all night long. Then that mystery man inflicted an injury to Jacob's hip, which caused him, Jacob, to limp for the rest of his life. That night the man renamed Jacob Israel, which more than likely means he struggles with God. Well, by then Jacob knew what had happened. He had seen God's face to face, and yet his life was spared. Most important, though, and unlikely of all, at the conclusion of that struggle on the riverbank, we read that God blessed him there. Did it take all that for Jacob to find a peace within himself? And did Jacob realize that God was by his side during that harrowing struggle? Theologian Daniel Clendenin states that the Jacob story jerks us back to reality. And he goes on to cite the Benedictine nun and writer Joan Chittister, sharing the Jacob story as a paradigm for a spirituality of struggle. In Jacob's story, she identifies 8 elements of our human struggle: change, isolation, darkness, fear, powerlessness, vulnerability, exhaustion, and scarring. But God doesn't leave us there, she says. In each human struggle, there is corresponding divine gift available to each of us, and a conversion of independence, faith, courage, surrender, limitations, endurance, and ultimately transformation. We too can do what Jacob did. He confronts himself with the things that are wounding him, and he admits his limitations. He accepts his situations, and he rejoins his world, and he moves on. God appeared to him and blessed him, and through it all, God was with him. The psalmist rings out and sings out, for his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Krista Tippett, the journalist and former diplomat and creator of the weekly public radio program Speaking of Faith, stated that people look for easy solutions and for the easiest way to be even easier. But everything in nature grows, and it fights to grow, and it struggles at every cost and against all resistance to remain complete in itself, and it's true to its fundamental nature. It's good to love, and it's good to be loved. Loving can be difficult. Love is perhaps the most difficult task given us, the most extreme and the final proof and test, the work which all other work is only preparation. Like Jacob, when he awoke, he declared, "Surely God is in this place," and he did not realize it. So it is with God, an ever-loving presence in our daily journeys, in good times, and in times of struggle. God promises to be with each of us on our journeys. We only have to quiet ourselves and look around us for the blessings of gifts around us that God has placed there for us to notice. And remember, it is good to remind oneself that the ever-constant presence of God in our lives and in the daytime, but especially in those quiet nighttime visits with God, they can be resting stops to reconnect and remind us that we are not alone and that we do have strength for the journey. May it be so, and amen. God is our creator and redeemer and our sustainer. God created us to care for one another, and God redeems us that we are made whole for one another. Our God sustains us in good times and in trying times so that we might know that we are never alone. And this is a time in our service where we lift up the joys and the sorrows of and celebrations of our church in the wider world, sharing them here in community and in the healing presence of God. We pray for all nations and leaders and communities, and particularly of this great country that we live in. May all examine their own hearts and peacemaking, and may they know your peace, God, as they work together to achieve it here on earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Loving God, we lift up in prayer your children, grown and small, experiencing health concerns, for their families and their healers, journeying with them, for their families, and also for those experiencing mental health difficulties, and all who are struggling with hardship, loneliness, and in grief. May they feel your abundant love and embrace of security and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. The congregation would, near and far, would like to thank Maya for sharing her beautiful gift of music this morning. Lord, in your joy, hear our prayer. Prayers for Carol Byatt, who is hospitalized following a fall. May God grant her healing and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. From Sarah Phelps, prayers for my cousin June Irvin, who passed away on August 2nd, surrounded by her loving family. She had suffered a stroke in January of 2021, and please keep in prayer her husband and her children and her family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Prayers asked for all those who suffer from addictions. May God help them and to find wholeness. Lord, in your prayers, our prayer. From Susan Deschenes, for my Aunt Jackie, who has severe problems with her heart, and sadly she is not healthy enough for surgery, so her prognosis is not good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. From Leona, strengthen and guide me in facing medical problems. And also, Lord Jesus, I ask your healing and power on my medical problems. And let your Holy Spirit empower my doctor to offer holistic options for my medical care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Leona also asks prayers for strength and calm for Ingrid and Daniel, helping Grandpa Grayson facing hospice care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Prayers asked for a swift and full recovery for Carol Forbes. Carol and Jim were active members of this church for decades and until moving to Kittery, Maine to be closer to the family. Lord, in your mercy. Let us now be in the spirit of prayer. Holy One, Creator and author of life, bless us as we worship this day, and we thank you for the beauty and the potential of the day before us, and we thank you for guiding our steps in all hours of the day and night as we navigate our way through your created world. Forgive us for the limits of our imagination and open our hearts and minds to your mysterious presence in our midst. Well, when illness and grief and the daily struggles of life overwhelm us, help us to imagine a God who is bigger than ourselves and is able to hold us up when we can no longer stand on our own. When people in our world are disregarded and devalued, and justice is offered to some, but not to all, help us to imagine a Savior who is more compassionate than we are, who includes even those we would exclude. When the struggles of the world overwhelm us and the motivation and the creativity we need to address these challenges are in short supply, help us, Lord, to imagine a Spirit who is more powerful and more creative than we could ever be. Lord God, loving Savior, empowering Spirit, may you pour out your healing presence upon us now as we offer up our gratitude and our joy and our sorrow in the prayers of the people and the situations that we've spoken here this morning. Hear now the silent prayers of our hearts and those that are too tender to give voice to, but still weigh heavily on our hearts. Loving God, may your abundant love and renewing spirit continue to call and gather and guide us as we seek to serve your good purposes. Pour your love in the world as we commit to wrestling toward the fulfillment of your reign on earth as it is in heaven. We pray all this in your holy name. Amen. God has supplied us with the abundant gift of life, compassion, service, and possessions. Let us now return a small portion back to God. For what has been given to us, we will now prepare to receive this morning's offering. Let us join our voices as we recite the prayer of dedication. God of power and glory, as we bring our tithes and offerings to be dedicated to the building of your kingdom here on earth, we are reminded of all the blessings we have received. As we hear again the story of Jacob wrestling with the stranger to receive his blessing. Remind us that the best blessings come when we are working hard, breaking a sweat, getting our hands dirty, working for justice, compassion, and mercy for all your children. Steer us away from being content with the blessings that require little effort. In Christ we pray. Amen. The order of communion will be received today by your coming forward when the ushers and I come in front of the table. So whatever side you are seated on, you will come down the aisle and then you will receive the bread and then go to what side of the aisle you are to the usher who has a cup of juice for you. And then there's a tray to place your cup in as you go back to your pew. Whenever we gather at this table to share in the bread and the cup in this community of faith, we proclaim Jesus' life, which affirms there's a place at the table for all people. For the love of God transcends every power that tries to contain it. You do not need to be a member of this church or any church and to partake in this meal. God is the host, and you are God's guest. So come to this table, not because you must, but because you may. God be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts to God. We lift them to God. Let us give thanks most high to God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Let us pray. Still speaking, God, in our varied walks of life, we meet here at these crossroads to share in the bread and the cup, which the earth has given and human hands have made. We meet here at this table, joining our hearts together in prayer and our lives together in the act of communion. Made one with Jesus Christ and thus one with each other and all those who have gone before us, in this act of breaking bread in community, we envision the world as you long for it to be. We embody the expansiveness of your love and the inbreaking of your kingdom here at this table, reminding us that we are all members of the one body of Christ. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Bless this bread and this fruit of the vine. And in the breaking of the bread, on the night of remembrance, Jesus with his disciples took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he said, "Take this and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." And in likewise, then he took the cup and he poured it out for his disciples and he said, "This is the blood of my new covenant. Take and drink and remember me as you drink." The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready. Come as you are able. Bread of life. Let us join in our prayer of thanksgiving for this small meal, but huge in the heart and giving. Dear God, in this place, at this table, may we be as the living loaves kneaded and shaped by the hands of God. May we be as wine of the Spirit poured out that others might know joy. Love be the heaven within. Love be the flavor of our thought and indeed. And may peace be among us.
Thank you.
today full of God's love and ready to receive notice of God in your daily walk. Go today at rest in God and ready to struggle with loving service to your neighbor in need. And as you go, may you find the face of God in all you meet, longing for kindness and wrestling with their daily grind. Go in peace, and the peace of God be with you always. Amen.